welcome to North Christian Church, an open and affirming congregation of the Christian Church Disciples of Christ. Today is Just Peace Sunday, closest to the International Day of Peace, which this year is September 21st. This is an opportunity for us to focus in prayer, study, and actions on ways to build peace in our community and around the world. The theme this year is Grow Justice, Know Peace. It's based on Psalm 1. Unfortunately, COVID-19 has struck the home of Reverend Tanya, and she has been asked by the Indiana State Department of Health to quarantine for 2 weeks. So today, we get me doing announcements. Mark Matheny will introduce in a second. She will continue to work remotely from home, participating in Zoom meetings, etc. Everything that she's able to do except in-person worship. In her absence, Mark Matheny will bring a message this Sunday. Mark is coordinating clergy person in the Christian Church Disciples of Christ, a graduate of Christian Theological Seminary, and former local church pastor, now working as a pastoral counselor. Thank you, Mark, for bringing the word to us today. A couple of reminders, one about our Afghan refugee neighbors here at Camp Atterbury. Disciples churches in our area are working together to collect items for donation, led by Pastor Carmen Ray of Tripout Christian Church. See the e-news sent out this week for details on participating in this much-needed ministry. Reminders that we are looking for helping with setup, operating, and breaking down our new technology equipment each Sunday morning so that our worship from home community can join us in our services. And last but not least, a reminder that we are wearing our masks during worship, doing our best to model good citizenship for the vulnerable around us. You are welcome to take your mask off to participate in communion, but please replace it after taking the elements. Also, if you have not already gotten your communion, please come down to the table during your first hymn and get it and take it back to your seat. Please join me in prayer. Wisdom cries out in the street, and what does wisdom say? She calls for us to listen and to love one another. We come today to listen and to love. Wisdom is here with us. We are ready to worship God. Merciful God, your wisdom calls to us, but we do not hear. We confess that we ignore your calls and your commandments to welcome the stranger. We exclude, ignore, and demean each other by drawing lines and building borders. Forgive our selfishness and our lack of imagination. Holy wisdom, stir our hearts and inspire us to build your peace in our communities. God of justice and peace, we don't always understand how your justice and your peace fit together. We don't always understand how our faith and actions can transform the world. As we read your ancient words again today, we ask your wisdom to speak again. Tell us of your great love for our immigrant and refugee neighbors. Show us your way of just peace. Amen. If you are able, I invite you to stand and join in singing our opening hymn, number 668 in your child's hymnal, for the healing of the nations. And number 668.
Thank you. book of James presents a collection of miscellaneous maxims by an unknown author to an unknown Christian community, or perhaps a group of communities, sometime during the second half of the first century. The credit of the work to James, the brother of Jesus, is traditional rather than historical. Today's lesson concerns wisdom in its practical, life-ordering, life-enhancing form. The wisdom of which the author speaks builds up the Christian community, an overriding concern in the entire letter. Listen to the word of God. Do you want to be counted wise, to build a reputation for wisdom? Here's what you do. Live well, live wisely, live humbly. It's the way you live, not the way you talk, that counts. Mean-spirited ambition isn't wisdom. Boasting that you are wise isn't wisdom. Twisting the truth to make yourselves sound wise is not wisdom. It's the furthest thing from wisdom. It's animal cunning, devilish plotting. Whenever you're trying to look better than others or get the better of others, things fall apart and everyone ends up at each other's throats. Real wisdom, God's wisdom, begins with a holy life and is characterized by getting along with others. It is gentle and reasonable, overflowing with mercy and blessings, not hot one day and cold the next, not two-faced. You can develop a healthy, robust community that lives right with God and enjoy its results only if you do the hard work of getting along with each other, treating each other with dignity and honor. Where do you think all these appalling wars and quarrels come from? Do you think they just happen? Think again. They come about because you want your own way and fight for it deep inside yourselves. You lust for what you don't have, and we are willing to kill to get it. You want what isn't yours, and will risk violence to get your hands on it. You wouldn't think of just asking God for it, would you? And why not? Because you know you'd be asking for what you have no right to. Your spoiled children, each wanting your own way. So let God work his will in you, yell aloud no to the devil, and watch himself make himself scarce. Say a quiet yes to God, and he'll be there in no time. Quit dabbling in sin, purify your inner life, quit playing the field, hit bottom and cry your eyes out. The fun and games are over. Get serious. Really serious. Get down on your knees before the Master. It's the only way you'll get on your feet. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. A 25-year-old brunette rock star, cigar-chomping octogenarian comedian, and a 60-ish-year-old black man. Alanis Morissette, George Burns, and Morgan Freeman. They all play God in the movies. Morissette didn't have any lines, but was God in Kevin Smith's 1999 film Dogma. George Burns appeared to John Denver in a plaid shirt and golf cap in Oh God, in the 70s. And more recently in Bruce Almighty, Morgan Freeman, as God, gives Jim Carrey a chance to have God-like powers, since Carrey was grumbling about God's on-the-job performance. What would you do if you were God for a week, or even a day? Maybe that's too big a question, filled with too many possibilities. Superhero movies are all the rage right now, so let's make the question a little smaller. Suppose you could have one of two superpowers, the power of invisibility or the power of flight. Which power would you choose? Would you rather fly free in the sky like Superman, or would you rather be able to turn invisible like the Invisible Woman of the Fantastic Four? Whichever power you pick, you will be the only person in the whole world to have that particular superpower. And you can't choose both, so it's one or the other, or none at all. Just like the genie and the three wish limit, there are some caveats. Invisibility means the power to become transparent at will, including your clothing. But anything you may pick up is still visible. Flight means the power to fly at any altitude within the Earth's atmosphere at speeds of up to 1,000 miles per hour. However, you don't get invulnerability or super strength. You know the limits. So which do you choose? Flight or invisibility? Now that you have your superpower, what do you do with it? On NPR's program, This American Life, John Hodgman conducted an informal, unscientific survey asking the question, which is better, the power of flight or the power of invisibility? What he found surprised him. No matter which power people chose, they used it in self-serving ways. Their plans weren't often flashy or heroic. In fact, they were almost never heroic, or even simply kind. Here's something that hardly anyone asked, ever mentioned, in his interviews. I will use my power to fight crime. No one seemed to care about crime or justice. Nobody wanted to work for peace, personal, local, or worldwide. No one tried to be merciful, or even just plain helpful. One typical respondent who had chosen flight commented, I don't think I'd want to spend a lot of my time using my power for good. I mean, if I don't have super strength and I'm not invulnerable, it would be very dangerous. Just having the power of flight, I don't think it's necessarily quite enough because you don't have the super strength. I'd still be weak when I'm out there. I don't fight crime now. He finished with, I'd go to Paris, I suppose. I could be going to Paris now. Going to Paris, man, is not much of a superhero. But his answer is telling. It might just be a representative reaction of all of us, if we're honest. Nobody interviewed on This American Life took responsibility for others less fortunate than themselves by using their superpowers for the common good. Helping the underdog, saving a drowning kitten, beating up bad guys? Nobody's interested. It turns out most people secretly, or even openly, have oodles of selfishness. This isn't surprising. It's the wisdom of the world. The Apostle James knows this about humanity, that we all have a level of selfishness and a powerful set of human cravings. We may successfully conceal our private jealousies, desires, and envies from others, but these are, as James points out, a devilish, destructive wisdom. Having superpowers, flight or invisibility, doesn't change our character. Actually, by using superpowers, we might unwittingly reveal our true character. It might not be so pretty. The superpower we need is divine wisdom. James calls it wisdom from above. The First Testament calls it Sophia. The Second Testament commonly calls it the Holy Spirit. According to both Proverbs and Job, wisdom was present with God at creation, and so is a part of the The awareness imparted by wisdom, while all-encompassing, is not shallow. However, and the discovery of wisdom's secrets demands diligent application and long experience. Wisdom is the tree of life, and those who depart from wisdom do so at their peril. James says, real wisdom, God's wisdom, begins with a holy life that is characterized by getting along with others. It is gentle and reasonable, overflowing with mercy and blessings. False wisdom, he says, is something altogether different. It is characterized by mean spirit and ambition. It is animal cunning, devilish plotting. Whenever you're trying to look better than others or get the better of others, things fall apart. James elaborates, where do you think all these appalling wars and quarrels come from? Do you think they just happen? And again, what to do? Well, James, if you read the whole epistle, is never one to leave us without some practical advice. You want to be truly wise and possibly powerful? Here's what you do. Submit yourselves to God, resist the devil, draw near to God, purify your hearts, lament, mourn, and weep, humble yourselves before the Lord. It's a nice list. But what does this scripture lesson have to say to us clearly here at North Christian Church? There is no doubt that we have our struggles, our questions, our own wrestling with our heart's desires, and each other's best guess as to what to do next, not to mention our doubts. How will we serve God humbly? How will we recognize wisdom in general, and God's wisdom more precisely? Now, before I go any further, I'd like to share a nugget of insight I was given once. People often think of intelligence, knowledge, and wisdom as all being the same thing. They are not. And here's how you know they aren't. Example. Intelligence is the ability to understand that some plants are fruits and some are vegetables, whether edible or not. Knowledge is knowing that tomatoes are edible fruits. And wisdom is knowing that you do not want to put tomatoes in your fruit salad. So back to God's wisdom. If I'm honest with myself and with all of you, humility doesn't always come easy to me. Pause for the laughter. And I struggle with the war between my desire to fix everything around me, by myself, to my own liking, and my human limitation to fix anything more than myself. My wife will tell you that I don't always do very well. God at fixing me. So where do I get off preaching about humility and wisdom? My response to that question is, I'm not. James is. Or, as many preachers will tell you, we preach best what we need to learn most. James says, unless our inner focus shifts from the earthly to the spiritual, we will wreak havoc on ourselves and others. It's a tall order, given our circumstances here at North. We chose to take the church building in a new direction, one that was more closely aligned with our stated purpose as a congregation. We chose to embrace a new path, and just as we were getting started, the pandemic hit and continues to hit. Choice was a battle? Were we not being wise? Were we focusing on earthly, physical matters of this magnificent but aging building when we should have been focusing on submitting to God? I don't think so. I remember those many, many meetings, agonizing over choosing what to do next. There were twists and turns, there were complete reversals, but what I remember most was the constant, ever-present talk about what minds that God wanted us to stay here and to do something different, be different, to grow in ways that we simply could not see clearly. As I was preparing for this sermon and looking for some meaningful quotation or two to use, I found this one from Paul Smith as quoted in Christianity Today. Renewing the church is like remodeling your house. It takes longer than you hoped. It costs more than you planned. And it makes a bigger mess than you ever thought possible. It was clear, even if our own sight is not. With the gift of holy wisdom, we can, even in our weaknesses, learn to live lives of compassion, clarity, tranquility, and tenderness. Which is exactly what James tells us God wants for us and from us. The tendency of American news media, 21st century social media, and politicians everywhere, has been to put all the blame for any societal breakdown on one group, always their opposition. And they do deserve their share of the blame. But not all. For each side of virtually every conflict has been lacking what James calls gentleness born of wisdom. Of wisdom from above. Of wisdom that is peaceable, willing to yield, full of mercy and without a trace of hypocrisy. Gentleness. Peaceable. Mercy, humble, and a host of other adjectives. God's wisdom would seem to be found and exercised most overtly when we pursue social justice, when we welcome the stranger, the outcast, when we protest oppression and discrimination, when we open the doors to this building and this worship space to all without exclusions. We may not always understand those that are not like us, but James is clear that God doesn't ask us to understand. That's knowledge. No, God's wisdom demands that we treat everyone as a child of God, worthy of respect, love, and grace, even if we don't see that worth. Yes, the one thing each side of any conflict, today or historically, has been lacking is gentleness born of the wisdom of God. Gentleness, justice, nonviolence that characterized Mahatma Gandhi, Martin Luther King Jr., and Nelson Mandela. Their wisdom was so nonviolent, full of sympathy, and without a trace of insincerity. Now, none of these men were flaws, as history has proven, but all walked the path of social justice they professed to believe, imperfectly, but always striving for the greater good. Let us all strive to allow God to lead us, to resist fear, to praise God daily, to focus our hearts on the good in people, to accept our losses, and humbly fall into the grace-filled, loving embrace of God. And it's not just for one of us. It's a gift to all of us. All of us are expected to be channels of spiritual wisdom for our own greater good and for the good of those around us. And the best part is, all we have to do is choose to ask God for divine wisdom and the strength of character to follow it. And we'll be real superheroes. Amen. You join with me in our communion hymn, Church of Christ in Every Age, number 475. done, God will draw near to us. In this time of communion, this love feast where we take God into our very bodies, we ask God to prepare our hearts and minds that we might receive God's grace and love. This table is God's table. It is open to all, just as God's love encompasses all of humanity, regardless of ethnicity, sexual orientation, or identification, regardless of political party or religious affiliation or spiritual practice, regardless of whether you feel yourself to be worthy of this gift, God gives it to you freely and with love.
God be with you, and also with you. O God, our mother and father, bread maker and wine maker, we give you thanks and praise. In Jesus Christ, the bread of life and the true vine, you feed us with the word and nourish us from the stalk. As we partake of this bread and fruit, we honor Creator and creation. As we bless and share these gifts, we celebrate the table fellowship of Jesus. Come, Holy One, come. Bless and prosper this meal of bread and wine. Bless and prosper this fellowship. Bless and prosper our lives, that justice and love may be the measure of our common witness. Come, you weary and restless. Come, all who hunger and thirst. Jesus calls us to dine as friends. Come, God's feast of welcome awaits us. Amen.
On the night of his arrest, Jesus was celebrating the Passover meal with all of his disciples, including the one who would ultimately betray him. If the Lord can offer up his body to Judas, he can certainly offer it up to us. In so doing, he said, as he broke bread, "This is my body, it's broken for you. Take and eat it." Likewise, the bitter wine came in remembrance of the quick exit from Egypt. But Jesus changed his meaning when he said, "This is the cup of a new salvation, a new covenant. It's my blood poured out for the forgiveness of all sin. Take and drink it."
Thank you.
forcefully that you lift up prayers for our most recent new residents of Indiana, the Afghan refugees, and for those Afghans, especially women, who remain in Afghanistan. Perhaps climate change is on your heart, and all of the incredible weather that's coming. Perhaps you think of Gabby Petitot and her family, missing young woman, who seems to represent all of the boys and girls and young men and women and their families that go missing every year around the world. Haiti continues to struggle with the effects and chaos of earthquakes. And another week has gone and another round of gun violence. I ask that we keep our hearts open for those with mental illness, the homeless, and for those who lack proper health care. And for those who are currently in an ICU, the medical staff struggling to care for them. There are many, many petitions we could bring. I'll give you a moment to lift your own personal. Gracious and loving God, you know our innermost hearts. We have nurtured jealousy and ambition, only to reap disorder and more. God of great joy, you offer us the gift of happiness, yet we continue to pursue what we think will make us happy. You give us a world of companionship, yet we ignore our neighbors. We fail to love even our families sometimes. You bless us with the beauty of creation, yet you threaten the planet entrusted to our care. You offer us abundant life, yet we chase after too many material goods. You promise us comfort and sadness and healing and sickness, yet we pretend that our lives are just fine. You have told us not to be afraid, that you walk with us even through the darkest valleys, yet we live according to the shadows of our fears. Merciful God, forgive us for following false paths. Like a tree planted by a running stream, plant us in your soil and nourish us in what is true, that we might be rooted in the goodness of all you offer. Even when we refuse your divine gifts, your hands remain outstretched. Even when we fail to recognize your loving desires for us, you continue to offer us possibilities for divine joy. Grant us just gentleness born of your wisdom from above, so that our works might be filled with your peace and mercy, sharing your love with all. We accept with grateful hearts the blessings of your love, grace, and mercy in our lives. We lift these prayers as we say together the prayer Jesus taught his disciples. Creator God, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread.
Amen.
ourselves to God's work of just peace, our time, our talents, and our money. God can grow an abundant harvest when we share what we have. Faithful God, you have kept your promises and sown seeds in our community. Our lives give witness to your abundant blessings. Your love sustains us, guides us, and empowers us. Take these gifts as signs of our promise to live without fear, to trust your love, and to serve as workers in the fields of your community. Amen. And please stand if you're able to join me in singing our final hymn this morning, number 600, J2, J2.
Help us to seize this day and all our days with exaltation and